Hello, I'm Graham and I hope everyone's having a great day and welcome to part 8 of my Photography on a Budget series. Now, first of all, an apology for the schoolboy errors I made in part 7. I kept referring to the Panasonic Lumix GX8 as the G7. Put it down to age, I don't know, but I never have had a G7, so where I got that from, I do not know. But unfortunately, I kept referring to it and the specifications for the G7 rather than the GX8. So the GX8 has a 20 megapixel sensor rather than the 16 megapixel that I quoted in that video. So it was in comparison really between the GX8 and the Olympus OMD M1 Mark II. Now, the only difference in that video I could see at a YouTube resolution was the fact that the Olympus had better colours. If you look at the images on a 27-inch iMac, there's very little difference between the JPEGs out of all the cameras. So again, that does prove to a degree that you can buy these older cameras and still get some fantastic pictures from them. Okay, we can't shoot video with a lot of the cameras, but you can get fantastic stills. Now, in today's video, I want to continue that theme with looking at two full-frame cameras. One is the 5D Classic, or the 5D Mark I, as you might want to call it, and the other is the last of the 5D series, which is the Mark IV. Now, we've seen the 5D Classic in an earlier video. I paid £200 for it from eBay. The 5D Mark IV I've had for a couple of months, and I bought that second-hand from Park Cameras. I've traded in my 5D Mark III. So the price difference is £1,700 between these two cameras. So are we going to get the difference in image quality between the 5D Classic at 12 megapixel and the 5D Mark IV at 30 megapixel? Of course, the 5D Mark IV will shoot 4K uncropped video, where unfortunately the 5D Classic doesn't shoot video at all. So if you do want hybrid video shooting, then you're going to have to use these later series of cameras. But for still shooting, I'm going to maintain there's going to be very little difference when we look at the 27-inch iMac resolution or YouTube resolution between the two cameras. Obviously, if you want larger prints, larger canvas prints, etc., you're going to want the higher resolution from the 5D Mark IV or earlier versions. Now, having said that, there is a facility in Photoshop now to enhance the resolution of your images by a factor of 2. So we could take the image from the 5D Mark I and upscale that to twice the resolution if we wanted larger prints. Now, that program works for some images but not for all, so it depends whether you want to suffer a little bit of image quality loss in some cases at the expense of getting larger file sizes, but you could do that anyway in the image edit upscaling facility in Photoshop without this new feature for the raw file increase in resolution. Now, to keep a level playing field for both of these cameras, I am going to be using the same ISO for each shot and the same aperture, etc. I am going to be using the same picture style, which will be standard with its default parameters, and all the other usual things are turned off or back to the standard default, things like lighting optimizer and those sort of things. And to keep the same image consistent, I'm going to be using the same lens for each shot, even though it means swapping out the lens for each shot and risking dust on the center, etc. I'm going to be using the 24-105 L-series F4 image stabilized lens. So it's a cracking lens, so it should be able to match the 30 megapixel resolution of the 5D Mark IV and give me better image on the 5D Classic. So let's have a look at some of the shots I've been shooting around Smithers Hall. It's my usual haunt where I want to test lenses and cameras. Some good architecture there, some high contrast scenes there. So it's going to be a good test for both of these cameras. Now, I'm hoping not to find too much difference in resolution when I look at them on the 27-inch iMac screen, and certainly not if we're looking at YouTube resolution or for social media or photo books, that sort of thing. Obviously, if you wanted larger pictures there for canvases or photo books, you might want a higher resolution file than this provides. Thank you. So there we are. We've seen some of the pictures that I've been shooting around Smithers Hall with both of these cameras, and I hope you can see if there's any difference. It's down to individual preference and not through the camera sensors. In the next video, again, I want to continue with the theme of capturing images using a cheap camera, which is going to be the Canon APS-C 40D, versus a higher-end camera, which is going to be the Canon 90D. Again, there's going to be something like a £1,000 price difference between the two cameras. So how are you going to get that £1,000 difference in image quality between the 40D and the 90D? Of course, again, the 90D will shoot 4K uncompressed video, where the 40D, unfortunately, doesn't shoot video at all again. So again, it's a choice of whether you want video or you want stills. So if you're a new viewer and you're liking this Photography on a Budget series, why not click the subscribe button and the bell notification icon to be advised when I upload that part 9. Also, if you've not seen my photography blog, I'll put a link to that in the video description below. On the homepage is the application form to join my newsletter group, and that is almost a magazine these days. It goes out to just under 4,000 people every month, and it contains a lot more technical information and articles that I don't publish on my photographic blog, as a way of saying thank you to your subscription and for watching my YouTube channel. On that photographic blog, you'll find lots more information about Canon cameras and the Panasonic range of bridge cameras and their mirrorless systems. So do check that out if you've not already been there. So as usual, thanks very much for watching this video. I do appreciate the time you've taken out to watch these videos, and I hope to see you all in the next one. So, goodbye for now.